that causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when he rose up from the Sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they rose up from the dead? Sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when he rose up from the dead. We saw thee not when thou didst come to this poor world of sin and death, nor yet beheld thy cottage home in that despised Nazareth. But we believe thy footsteps trod its streets and plains, thou Son of God. Yes, we believe thy footsteps trod its streets and plains, thou Son of God. We saw thee not when lifted high amid that wild and savage crew, nor heard we that imploring cry, forbid they know not what they do. But we believe the deed was done that shook the earth and veiled the sun. Yes, we believe the deed was done that shook the earth and veiled the sun. Not in the open tomb where once thy mangled body lay, nor saw thee in that upper room, nor met thee on the open way. But we believe that angels said, why seek the living with the dead? Yes, we believe that angels said, why seek the living with the dead? But we believe thy footsteps trod its streets and plains, thou Son of God. Yes, we believe thy footsteps trod its streets and plains, thou Son of God.
Hello everyone! I hope you are enjoying this season of Lent, because I know I sure am. Today we have got another very important Bible story to learn about. So let's turn on our listening ears and go find out what Bible story we're hearing today.
The religious leaders told the governor, Pilate, that Jesus was dangerous and wanted to be king. Pilate asked Jesus,
"Is this true?"
"I am king," Jesus answered, "but not of this world."
"Jesus is innocent," said Pilate. "There's no reason to kill him. I will set him free."
But the crowd shouted,
"Kill him!"
So Pilate had his soldiers whip Jesus. They forced a thorny crown on his head. Then they laid a wooden cross on his back and led him up a hill. There on that hill, the Roman soldiers nailed Jesus to the cross, hands and feet. Then they raised it high. Jesus hung there between two criminals. Around noon, the sky turned dark. Jesus' friends wept. The religious leaders laughed and said,
"You saved other people. Why can't you save yourself?"
"Forgive them, Father," said Jesus. When the time came for Jesus to die, he closed his eyes and said, "It is finished." He had completed what he had come to do because of his great love. One of Jesus' followers, a man named Joseph, put Jesus' body in a brand new tomb. He rolled a huge stone in front of it. A long, sad Friday was over.
What an amazing story that was. It's so exciting to be nearly to Easter, and to be talking about Easter because it's one of the best times of the year. It's one of the best times in all of history because it is the time that Jesus rose from the dead to save us. That's a big story. But whoa, we're getting way ahead of ourselves. We need to back up just a little bit and talk about what Jesus and his disciples were doing right before Easter started. So today's story talks about that time period. So Jesus had spent some time with his disciples, and like the video said, he taught them all about the vine and he taught them about the branches. But they had a dinner, and then Jesus went to pray in the Garden of Gethsemane, and soldiers came, scary Roman soldiers, and they arrested him. And they took him to a courtroom to be questioned and to be sentenced. In other words, to decide how he would be punished. And he was so special that the man who was chosen to interview him was named Pilate. Pilate interviewed Jesus and talked to him about what he did, or thought that he did wrong. And Pilate decided that Jesus did nothing wrong. But Pilate was very afraid of Jesus because he was so powerful. And Pilate still made the decision, because the people wanted him to put Jesus to death. And that's an incredible thing. Jesus was so special that when he was dying on the cross, he asked God in a prayer to forgive people who put him on the cross. Now, isn't that incredible that he would do that? And you know, we all are in a position somewhat when we are asked or we need to be forgiving someone who made us mad or someone who hurt us that we think. And how hard is that? Because we think, well, I'm not going to forgive them. Because if I do, then they win and I lose. But you know, Jesus taught us that that's not how it works out. That when we need to forgive someone, we win and they win. Because that's what happened with Jesus on the cross. When he forgave them, he went to heaven. And they saw their sin and they decided to do right. So Jesus was able to forgive because he knew he would feel better and because he was obeying God. So Jesus never sinned. I want you to know this. He never sinned or made a wrong choice, but he still was put to death on the cross. Why? Because did the world make Jesus do that? No, he did it because he loves everyone. And that means he loves you. And he loves you no matter what. And that's the big lesson of Jesus dying on the cross and on Easter, rising again to live again and to preach again and to teach his disciples even more. So we have to know that Jesus loved everyone he met, and he wants us to do the same. Now, let's find out what our craft is today. It ought to be amazing if it's going to help remind us of this story.
For this week's craft, you will need last week's craft, which you'll set aside for later, paper, something to color with, glue or tape, a hole punch, and scissors. We are continuing to add on to our banner today as we celebrate Lent and getting closer to the greatest day ever, Easter. Take a piece of paper and make another large triangle from it. Punch two holes in the top of the triangle on either side and then set it aside. Now, take your brown paper and draw three crosses on it, with one cross being a little bigger than the other two. If you don't have brown paper, draw the crosses on half a piece of plain paper and color them brown. After you've finished drawing the crosses, cut each of them out. On your triangle, draw a hill on the bottom. This will be the hill that Jesus' cross was on when he died. Glue the three crosses on your triangle on top of the hill with the biggest cross in the middle. The biggest cross is representing the cross that Jesus died on long ago. Above the crosses, write, "Jesus died so that we can live." John 18:28-19:42. String this triangle onto the ribbon or string that you have last week's hanging on. You should have four triangles total hanging on your string. Hang your banner back up where you will see it so you're reminded of the season of Lent that we are in as Easter gets closer. We will add the final triangle to our banner in next week's craft to celebrate the greatest day ever.
Wow, what an amazing story that was today. Jesus was the perfect person, but he was still punished. He wasn't punished for a mistake that belonged to him, but he was punished for our mistakes and wrong choices. I don't know about you, but that makes me so happy to know Jesus loves me that much. Let's pray together before we say goodbye. God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the fact that he shows us love on the cross. Thank you for teaching us about love and forgiveness through Jesus. Amen. Don't forget, ask your parents to post a picture of you on the Springs Facebook page so we can all see what you added onto your Lent craft today. I would love to see what you've created so far. I'm sad to say that's all for today, but I can't wait to see you next week, because next Sunday we will be celebrating the greatest day ever, Easter. I am so excited. I'll see you then. Bye. Good morning. Whether you are joining us in person or online, we are so thankful you are here this morning. Sunday is next week. We will be having two services and no Bible class that Sunday morning. The first service will be at 9 a.m. and the second at 10:30 a.m. Please scan the QR code or visit thesprings.cc to RSVP which service you will attend. We are looking to relaunch our connection groups on May 1st. Through connection groups, you can develop friendships and build your faith as you grow with one another. Let's do life together. For more information, please contact our connection group delegate, Jason Henley. We are so grateful to be with you this morning. Let's worship together.
Good morning, church. Let's stand and worship together. Well, it's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. This song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all our children singing glory, glory. Sound.
Echoes from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground.
Of all the songs from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. Go ahead and be seated.
Good morning, church. Rachel and I get to read with the girls today about Lent and our Sunday coming into Easter. And I just wanted to share a moment to set this up. We're going to share a scripture about Jesus coming into Jerusalem, and the people made a space for God, and they made a space for his son in this moment. And the whole point of Lent is looking at how his light is being extinguished in our world and in his world at that time. And I just want to pause for a moment and think about the purpose of Lent not being as a time where we give things up, but think about it in terms of a place where we have made a space for God.
The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written of him and had been done to him.
Mama, come on.
Good morning. I want to welcome everyone to the Springs. Thank you so much for coming. You guys are all welcome here, whether you're here for 20 years or 2 weeks. You matter, and we're very grateful that you've chosen to come here today. I want to thank everyone who attended the service day we had yesterday at the Redlings. We had too many people show up. It was amazing. We got a lot done, and I just want to say thank you so much to those who had an opportunity to serve part of our family. I've also got some other pictures to show you. Maybe in a couple minutes. I'll fast forward. Here we go. So these pictures I'm going to show you, I see entrepreneurs. I see some empty nesters. I see past infertility, church leadership, grandparents raising grandchildren. I see old and new marriages, blended families. I see a lot of wisdom. How did that get in there? I see tight bonds between friends. I see people who listen and who are honest, and people who will show up at your door at 2 a.m. if needed. I see people who take meals to families who just had a baby or who are sick, and people who create space for your questions with open arms. They help carry burdens when you don't feel worthy, and these people provide hope and comfort and don't judge you when you fall apart. They provide grace without condition. These are my people. This is my connections group. So if you had a picture, who'd be in your picture? What pictures could you show from your home? We're going to relaunch Connections Groups May 1st. And don't everyone worry all at once. That's not the same for everyone. Relaunching looks different. We're going to look at next steps. So some of those next steps are maybe just contacting those who you've been in contact with from your connections group. Start that text thread again or that email. Just say, "Hey, how you doing? What's going on? Where are you guys at?" I'm sure most of you guys are already staying connected. And some of those next steps may be, "Hey, May 1st, does that sound doable? Does it not? What can we do to help make it a safe environment? Or we're going to start meeting a little bit, you know, with maybe a couple or two." Some of those next steps might look like, do we meet indoors? Do we meet outdoors? Do we wear masks? Do we not wear masks? Do we use the church environment where we can space out and have more space. If anything, the relaunch for Connections Groups just gives you permission to start thinking about meeting again, or at least talking, whether we're going to do it on Zoom or in person. Even if not everyone is ready to meet in a Connections Group environment. So you're going to have some people that, you know, vaccination, maybe they're not ready, maybe they just want to give some more time, and that's okay. It's going to be different for every Connections Group. But we do want to start thinking about the opportunities for inviting more people. Our family's growing. We've got visitors. I've had a lot of people come to me that are really either new to the Springs or just visiting that want to get connected. And I'm really trying to find a place for them to settle in, to try a group or two, to try it out. So if five of your family units, if two of you are going to meet and the other three maybe are out of town or not ready to meet, that's okay. You've got an open chair. And we want to give maybe somebody an opportunity who's visiting to try out and visit one of our Connections Groups and see our family. So I'll be in the lobby on the way out, on your way out. So if you have any questions or whatever, I'd love to meet you if you're visiting, or if you have questions about maybe your next step. And me and the church staff, we really want to help you talk through that conversation or see what we can do to help you in your next step, whether it's using the church facility, extra masks, whatever you're going to need. So let's pray about that, what that next step may look like, or just what family is to us and who would be in your picture. So pray with me. Father God, we invite you in today to this building, to our hearts, to our homes. God, help us feel worthy. Help us feel your presence close to us. God, we thank you for what you're doing within our church family. We thank you for Sundays and the opportunity to worship you in an environment with other family members. God, we are blessed because of what you've done for us, and we are grateful for what you continue to do in our lives. And it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Will you stand and join us in worship?
You touched the leper, you healed the withered hand, you calmed the stormy sea, you are the Son of Man, you fed the hungry and filled the crowds with awe. You were, you are the Son of God. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe. Come follow Jesus, the Holy One of God. Walked on water, brought sight to the blind. You spoke the gospel, forgave these sins of mine. And now we praise you as members of your church. You were, you are, and we proclaim your word. You. God is here. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe, repent and believe. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe, come and follow Jesus, the Holy One.
Thank you.
we thank you, we worship you. We thank you for this season where we just remember what you did on the cross. But not only that, that 3 days later that you raised up from the dead and that you live always. And that you left your spirit with us. And God, we just praise you for that. We love that you have done that for us. And we remember this time as we take your Holy Communion. In Jesus' name, amen. If you need prayer, the elders will be in the lobby.
In the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. Into your careful hand, when I trust you, I don't need to understand. So make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil new wine.
Let's be standing as we sing our next song. This song has a lot of hallelujahs in it. And as I think of how we say hallelujah, sometimes there's a time for a hushed, awestruck hallelujah. And there's also a time for a jubilant hallelujah. And I think we have both of those in this song. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior, bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Guilty, vile, and helpless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. Lifted up was he to die, it is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high, hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew this song we'll sing, hallelujah, what a Savior. In heavenly armor we'll enter the land, the battle belongs to the Lord. No weapon that's fashioned against us will stand, the battle belongs to the Lord. As we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. When the power of darkness comes in like a flood, the battle belongs to the Lord. He's raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. When your enemy presses in hard, do not fear. The battle belongs to the Lord. Take courage, my friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord.
Amen. You guys go ahead and take a seat.
Amen. Good morning, Springs Church. Welcome, everybody here, in the name of Jesus Christ. Welcome, everybody online. We are missing you, and we love you, and we're grateful that you're tuning in. I want to remind you once again that next week is Easter Sunday, April 4th, and we are adding a service, as I said last week. We're going to have our regular 10:30 slot, and we'll have an early service at 9. We're going to try and accommodate for all the COVID spacing we've been doing, as well as the uptick in numbers that we always happily get around Easter. So if you're a visitor, we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to connect with you, and we'd love for you to fill out a visitor card so we can know how to get in touch with you. But also, this QR code right here, if you even want to pull out your iPhone and just point your camera at it, that will help you find the link that'll let you RSVP to let us know which service you're coming to next week, 9 a.m. or 10:30. We're really, really excited to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord with you this morning. So good to have new faces trickling in all the time. My family's here this morning, so pardon the saliva and Belvita cracker on my blazer. It's kind of a new experience for me to get to preach with them in the room. So we're in the Gospel of Mark this morning, following Jesus. And we've been kind of jumping around the middle of the gospel, the beginning, the end. But from here on out, starting this morning, we're kind of jumping back to the beginning, and we'll be trotting sequentially through the rest of the gospel. So we find ourselves in Mark chapter 3 this morning, verses 1 through 12. Again, Jesus entered the synagogue, and a man was there who had a withered hand. They watched Jesus to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, "Come forward." Then he said to them, "Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? To save life or to kill?" But they were silent. Jesus looked around at them with anger. He was grieved at their hardness of heart and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately conspired with the Herodians against Jesus, how to destroy him. Jesus departed with his disciples to the sea, and a great multitude from Galilee followed him. Hearing all that he was doing, they came to him in great numbers from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, beyond the Jordan, and the region around Tyre and Sidon. He told his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, so that they would not crush him, for he had cured many, so that all who had diseases pressed upon him to touch him. Whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and shouted, "You are the Son of God!" But he sternly ordered them not to make him known. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we praise you this morning as the Son of God. We lift up your name. And we give thanks, Lord, for healing our diseases. We give thanks for forgiving our sins, for restoring us to new life. And Jesus, I thank you for your life that is present within this body. Help us to discern that life and to see how we can repent and believe in the good news of your kingdom. Jesus, I ask for the gift of preaching this morning, and we ask for the Holy Spirit's illumination of this text. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Imagine a young college football quarterback who becomes a breakout star overnight. So our guy grew up in Ohio, and he goes to school in Vanderbilt, and he's the second string QB there until, lo and behold, the starter gets injured. And he gets a chance to start a game, and sure enough, he throws 11 touchdown passes in a single game. He ties the record for the single game college football touchdown passes. Next week, he gets up, he starts again, he does it again. 11 touchdown passes in a single game. Third week, he does it a third time. Suddenly, people start reacting to this guy. right? And there's three groups in particular that have a really specific response to this young upstart QB, right? The first group of people is the Vanderbilt fans. They love this guy, right? He's incredible. They don't know him from Adam. They've never heard of him before. He was the second string QB. They don't know him, but now they love him. They're selling out every game. Okay, the second group responding to him is the Alabama Crimson Tide, their football team, right? They're in the same conference as Vanderbilt, and usually they win that conference, but now this guy, he's about to roll over their chances, right? This guy, he's impeding upon the season they thought they were going to have. They don't know this guy, but they know they don't like him. And in fact, they'd love for somebody to take him out before he ruins their season. And then there's a third group. And the third group responding to this young upstart QB is Ohio State. They were slated to win it this year. They were going to go all the way. They were the odds-on favorites. And in fact, they, oddly enough, know this guy. Remember, he's from Ohio. He grew up there. They saw him play in high school. But now he's at Vanderbilt, and now he is seriously challenging their ability to win the NCAA football championship. This morning in Mark's gospel, in the early chapters of Mark, Jesus is having a breakout season. Jesus hits the ground running in Mark. It's a really fast-paced gospel. And from day one, from the get-go, Jesus is running around and he's casting out demons and he's healing diseases and he's forgiving sins and he's making a big fuss and people start to notice. And in particular, there are three groups that I want to look at this morning that have a very specific response to Jesus and all that he's doing in Mark's gospel. So let's start this morning by jumping back into Mark 3, our text, but about halfway through in verse 7. Jesus departed with his disciples to the sea, it says, and a great multitude from Galilee followed him. Hearing all that he was doing, they came to him in great numbers from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, beyond the Jordan, and the region around Tyre and Sidon. He told his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, so that they would not crush him, for he had cured many, so that all who had diseases pressed upon him to touch him. So one thing we know about Jesus is that he could sell some tickets. Right? Jesus is gathering crowds around him wherever he goes because he's doing these marvelous deeds. And so that's the first group responding to Jesus, the crowds. And the crowds, you'll notice, love him. The crowds are mysteriously, magnetically drawn to Jesus. There are so many people that they're going to crush him on the seashore, and Jesus has to request a boat so he can get out into the lake. Right? The crowds love Jesus. They're attracted to him. They want to know what's going on. But here's the thing about the crowds. They don't know Jesus. This guy just popped up out of nowhere. Some podunk town called Nazareth. Jesus just came out of nowhere. They don't know who he is. There's kind of this mystery surrounding him. They don't understand Jesus, but they know they want to follow him. Remember back in Mark chapter 1, verse 27, it says, they were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, what is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him? At once, Jesus' fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. What is this? The crowds don't know or understand Jesus, but they know they really want to get in on what he's doing. They really want to follow him. But there's a second group, another group responding to Jesus in the early chapters of Mark. There's the crowds, and then there's what I'm calling the clergy. Okay, so the clergy includes the Pharisees, the scribes, the teachers, and experts in the law. And we see the Pharisees in particular, their response at the start of our story, beginning in verse 1. So again, Jesus entered the synagogue, and a man was there who had a withered hand. They watched Jesus to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, "Come forward." Then he said to them, "Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? To save life or to kill?" But they were silent. He looked around at them with anger. He was grieved at their hardness of heart and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately conspired with the Herodians against him, how to destroy him. So the Pharisees, you've probably heard tons of stories about the Pharisees. They're an interesting group because they've been around for about 200 years when Jesus comes along. And they're kind of this religious, political pressure group. And what's interesting about them is they didn't have any actual authority of their own. They weren't actually vested with any real power to make or write or enforce laws. So the power, the authority that the Pharisees had was they were kind of opinion makers, right? The Jewish people at large respected them as, you know, experts in Israel's ancestral traditions. So they don't really have any deep power. And what happens here, though, is that they purport to have these very strict adherences to Sabbath laws, right? To laws around fasting, laws around the Sabbath, laws around purity. They set up these kind of laws, and Jesus is transgressing them, right? Jesus is like, "Hey, is it right to do good or harm on the Sabbath?" As he brings this man forward with the withered hand. He says, "Is it right to save life or to kill?" Pharisees are silent. And then it says that they went out immediately, in verse 6 here, and conspired with the Herodians against Jesus, how to destroy him. So the Pharisees, this is precisely why they have to conspire with the Herodians, because they don't have any real power of their own, right? They can't really enforce anything. And so they conspire with the Herodians, who are actually kind of their natural born enemies. The Pharisees were very skeptical of King Herod, who was considered by them to be kind of a traitor of Judaism, a dangerous guy. And the Herodians were Herod's supporters. But they're so desperate to take on Jesus that they will ally themselves with their natural enemies. All right? And notice here, the word that Jesus uses for kill, right? In verse 4, Jesus says, should we do good or harm on the Sabbath? Should we save life or kill? That word kill is closely tied in the Greek to the word that Mark uses for the Pharisees, that the Pharisees now want to go out and destroy Jesus. Jesus says, what should we do on the Sabbath? Save life or destroy it? Pharisees say, we're going to destroy Jesus. So unlike the crowds who don't know Jesus but are really drawn to following him, the Pharisees don't know Jesus, but they don't want anything to do with him. They're repulsed by him, and in fact, they want to destroy him. They'd like to get rid of him because he's challenging their little kingdom of power. And they'll really stop at nothing, right? They will conspire with the Herodians, and they will even attribute to Jesus the demonic. We see this later on in Mark chapter 3, right? There's this kind of mystery surrounding Jesus' identity. He's doing these supernatural things. And in Mark 3, verse 22, it says that the scribes, who I'm also including in this group, the clergy, the scribes came down from Jerusalem, said, "He has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons." Beelzebul is just another name for Satan, another name for the devil, essentially. And the scribes here are attributing to Jesus the demonic, attributing to him Satan. They're saying he's possessed by Satan. And Jesus, in that story, quickly kind of untangles their terrible logic. He says, how can Satan cast out Satan? Right? If Satan is casting out Satan, then Satan's kingdom is done, clearly. But they will stop at nothing. The clergy are so opposed to Jesus that they will even attribute the demonic to him. The crowds don't know Jesus, but their response is to follow. And then there's a third group. There's a third group who knows exactly who Jesus is. And they don't want to touch him with a 10-foot pole. And that group is the demons. Notice the response of the unclean spirits, of the demons, in the opening chapters of Mark. So in our passage in verse 11, whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and shouted, "You are the Son of God." But he sternly ordered them not to make him known. In Mark 5, we're going to get that great story of the guy who's living among the tombs and he's breaking his chains and he's possessed by so many spirits that they call themselves legion. And in that, Mark chapter 5, verse 7, it says, he shouts at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you, by God, do not torment me." And then once more, returning to a story that Ben read back in chapter 1 of Mark, verse 23. "Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, 'What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God.' But Jesus rebuked him, saying, 'Be silent and come out of him.' And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him." The crowds don't know Jesus, but they want to follow. The clergy don't know Jesus, but they want to destroy him. The demons, they know exactly who Jesus is. And they're scared. Right? The demons are using a title for Jesus that no other human so far has used for Jesus: Son of God. In the very first verse of Mark, the narrator, Mark, tells us that Jesus is the Son of God. But in these opening chapters and through most of the gospel, no human ever calls Jesus Son of God. The only people who know Jesus is the Son of God is the demons. And these demons are shaken in their boots because they believe, as you can see, that Jesus has come to get them, to confront them, to destroy them. And you know what? They're right. The demons are right about who Jesus is. They're right about what he's doing. That the coming of Jesus has initiated this decisive conflict between the powers of God and the powers of darkness. Right? That the coming of Jesus, the coming of God's kingdom, has initiated this decisive conflict between the kingdom of God and the present evil age. The demons are scared of Jesus because they know he's come to confront them. And suddenly, once you see that, you see everything in the Gospel of Mark differently. Right? Once you see this conflict at the heart of the gospel, you start to understand all the other turmoil happening in the gospel. It's like being a part of an organization or maybe a school or a team. Have you ever been a part of an organization that had a lot of conflict going on? And there's a lot of turnover and change and turmoil, and you're just kind of struggling to understand it. And then maybe you get in a room and you're with two people and you see them kind of going at it. And you start to understand, wait a minute, this is kind of the center of the conflict. Right? These two people are having a beef, and it's kind of spreading out into all these other beefs, right? This whole turmoil can probably be kind of traced back to this confrontation right here. That's what's happening in the Gospels, right? There is a major confrontation happening in Mark because Jesus has shown up to confront the demons. Jesus has initiated the reign of God in the world that is overcoming all the powers of darkness at work in the world. And suddenly you see that from the very beginning of Mark. This is the confrontation, right? Right after Jesus is baptized, the Holy Spirit in verse 12 immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. And then we go through these first few chapters, and Jesus is casting out demons. He's healing diseases. He's forgiving sins. He's confronting the works of darkness. And in fact, the letter of 1 John, which is a very different text in the New Testament than Mark, but speaks into our reading of it. 1 John says simply, the Son of God was revealed for this purpose, the Son of God, that title, to destroy the works of the devil. The demons know Jesus is the Son of God. And they're scared because they know he's come to challenge their kingdom. Jesus has come to undo the works of the devil, of the Satan, right? That Old Testament Hebrew word, the Satan, it means the accuser. We've talked about this before. So Satan is this force of accusation, this force of negation, trying to undo God's good creation. And Jesus has come to undo the works of Satan. He's come to negate the negator, right? He's come to destroy the power of destruction and death. Jesus has come to destroy the works of the devil, to undo hypocrisy, injustice, violence, oppression, sin, disease, and death. Because as Ben said, there is a new sheriff in town. And when the reign of God shows up, the demons shudder. Crowds don't know Jesus, but they know they want to follow him. Their response is to be drawn to Jesus. The clergy, they don't know Jesus, but they know they don't want a thing to do with him. They know they actually want to destroy him because Jesus is challenging their little kingdom. But the demons know Jesus, and they are shaking in their boots. Because Jesus has come to destroy the works of the devil. These are the responses that we get to Jesus in the early chapters of Mark. These are the responses we get. And so, church, it raises for us the question this morning. How will we respond to Jesus? How will you respond to Jesus? Jesus is a powerful word that demands a response. Right? And to disregard him or to delay the response is itself a kind of response. Right? Jesus has come to undo the works of darkness, to undo the forces of evil. And he demands a response from us. So the question is, will we repulse him? Will we try to rid ourselves of him? Or will we run to him? How will we respond to Jesus? Will we choose to follow him even when we don't fully understand him like the crowds? Will we choose to follow him anyway, to join in on his work of life-saving kingdom work, to join in on his resistance, his undoing of hypocrisy, injustice, violence, oppression, sin, disease, and death? Will we join into that work? Will we repent and believe in the good news? Will we be baptized into the good news of that kingdom to join Jesus in his life-saving salvation? How will you respond to Jesus? Maybe a better way to ask it, how are you responding to Jesus right now? Every breath, every moment, every word, every deed is a response to the good news of Jesus who has shown up to undo and destroy the works of darkness. May we begin that response by standing and praising Jesus, the Son of God.
And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word.
So I got you, I see you.
Church. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. Thanks for tuning in, those of you online. I hope if it's healthy and safe for you that you'll be here next week with us at one of our Easter services to celebrate Jesus' triumph in the resurrection over the powers of sin and death in the world. So grateful to be with you this morning, and I want to leave you with this charge. May you respond to Jesus by living into the good news of God's reign. Go in peace, church.
You touched the leper. You healed the withered hand. You called the stormy sea. You are the Son of Man. You fed the hungry and filled the crowds with awe. You were, you are, you are the Son of God. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe in the good news. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe. Come follow Jesus, the Holy One of God. You walked on water, brought sight to the blind. You spoke the gospel, forgave these sins of mine. And now we praise you as members of your church. You are, and we proclaim your word. The kingdom of God is
does want to go on a date. Maybe it's the timing.
My mom doesn't want to go on a date. What's up? You good? I love your dress.